got something going on with the... Y'all didn't get the intro. Here's 5 more minutes of intro. Want to make sure you got your coffee and donut down. Once you stand up, join us. If you don't know somebody around you, shake their hand, hug their neck, if they'll let you. Oh, there comes Michael. He's got his coffee and donut. He's ready to go. Can you believe it's a new year tomorrow? I'm glad you survived the reindeers. Your grandma's coming over. So. If you join online, welcome to Tree of Life in Pflugerville, Texas. We're so glad you're here this morning. Just begin to invite the Lord to come and have his way this morning. Acknowledge his presence. He's here. Come on, acknowledge his presence. Thank him that he brought you through 2023. Begin to thank him for all the blessings that are going to come forth in 2024. He's worthy of all our praise. Come on, just begin to thank him this morning. Open up your gates. Give you all the praise.
Pray. Fire with me in the storm. you what your love has meant. I'm lost for words. Is there a way to show the passion in my heart? Can I misplace how truly great you are, my dearest friend?
Like water on your feet, like
Lord, for this day, Lord. God, we just thank you for your presence. Father, I ask you to just guide us today, Lord. Open our eyes that we might see. Open our hearts that we might feel your presence, Lord. Open our ears that we may hear what you're telling us, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings, for your love, and for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning, everyone. If you don't know me, I'm not Pastor Cheryl. I'm Linda Lawson. I am one of the ladies ministries, the WOW team leaders. I work in the hostessing portion. And so I just want to introduce you myself. And then I have the honor of doing the announcements today. Pastor Mike and Pastor Cheryl are on a much needed vacation. And they will be back here next Sunday. So never fear, our fearless leaders will be back. So I want to welcome everybody, if this is your first time here, and those that are online to Tree of Life Church, if this is your first time, if you don't mind slipping your hand up so we can just tell you hello and welcome. Thank you for coming to our church.
Amen.
We have a connection card that is on the flyer that should have been given to you. If you'll fill that out, we'll send you a little letter. We'll pray over you if you have any prayer requests. Or if you're online, there's a online an area where you can connect also where we can reach you. So I got a scripture, a couple of them. So it's Isaiah 43 and 18. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So if you don't know it, today is 1-2-3-1-2-3. 12-31-23. In case you didn't know that. It's the last day of the year. And 2023 has definitely been an interesting year.
Amen.
And 2024 is probably going to be very interesting also. Amen. But you know what? We know who the author and the finisher of everything is.
Yes.
We know that God can do anything. He can heal us from any disease. He can get us through anything that comes our way if we believe and we are faithful, because he is a faithful God. So as we leave 2023 behind and we go into 2024, several of us will make New Year's resolutions and try to, not think about 2023, move on to 2024. And so I challenge you this next year to make a resolution, not only to be healthy, because all of us need to be healthy, but to also to grow spiritually with the Lord.
Amen.
And this church is our church, of course. It's God's home. And we need you. We need you to sign up and do things in any of the ministries. There's tons of ministries. We need people in sound. We need people in coffee ministry. We need people greeting, children's church, youth. There's so much we need help with. We just need you. I challenge you to step out and join a group. A lot of us put a lot of work into our little events that we do, and it's sad that sometimes people can't make it, and we try really hard to do things. And so if you're there, you get plugged in, and you'll be part of the family, and we are a family. Now, last night, we had our 50s couples meet last night, and I actually had a wonderful time. We played some games. We had plenty of food, but I met some wonderful people. I met Miss Esther, which was just a blessing to us, and got to know the Moons really well, and, of course, Ginger and Dave, our besties, are over here, and we just had a really good time just getting connected and loving each other and just being together. So we have some upcoming things. So everybody get your bulletins out so you can read them along with me. So first one is we're not having any service on Wednesday. The second is we're having a prayer meeting on Thursday, January 4th at 6 p.m. here in the sanctuary. All are welcome as we pray and believe through breakthroughs in our city and the church. We also pray in the prayer room on Sunday mornings at 9:15 upstairs in room 20. great way to get connected. Contact Pastor Cheryl for more information on that one. Our men's breakfast, led by Brother Jack and Luke Hatley, is happening this next Saturday on January 6th at 8 a.m. This is another event that they put a lot of stuff into, so gentlemen, pack it up and come on Saturday. They'll have breakfast tacos and coffee here at the church, and this is a monthly event. On Wednesday, January 10th, we're having Undeck the Halls. So this beautiful church with all the lights and stuff, it took us quite a bit, and Susan a lot of work. We got to take it all down and make our church undecked. So that's on Wednesday, January 10th. It starts at 7. And then last but not least, we have a chili cook-off. That is on Sunday, January 14th, right after church. So you don't even have to go anywhere. You just got to stay after church. Contestants can enter for free, and prizes will be awarded. The cost to participate in the dinner is $10 per person with a $30 cap per family. Chili, sides, and desserts will be served. All funds will go towards kids ministry. So if you need any information, it's at the information booth where you will sign up to win the chili cook-off. I think Jesse Carlo is the standing winner, and we need some contestants. We need to kind of knock him off of number one if we can. I know you can do it. But anyway, here's Brother Jack. God bless y'all.
Bless the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you guys pass out offering envelopes? I wanted to share a word concerning an offering. This is out of starting in Luke 6:46. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? Jesus is saying the true lordship requires obedience to the Lord. In Luke 6:47 through 48, it says, "As for everyone who comes to me and hears my words and puts them into practice, I will show you what they are like. They are like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on a rock. When a flood came, the torrent struck the house, but it could not shake it because it was built upon the rock. To have a solid foundation, you must build your house on the things of God, the teachings of the Lord." Luke 6:49, "But the one who hears my words and does not put them into practice is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. The moment the torrent struck the house, it collapsed. Its destruction was complete. Is your foundation made upon the rock or shifting sand? Are you a wise builder or a foolish builder?" In James 1:22, it says, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Faith comes by hearing the word of God, by acting on or obeying the word of God. It shows that you truly trust God. Would you expect God to bless you with your finances when you ignore the teachings on this subject? Why not build your house on the rock, and when the storms of life come, you will have faith to preserve it?" Anyway, that's my teaching on tithing. Would you guys come forward and we're going to pray? So I'm going to ask you to pull your wallet out of your pocket. You know, that's that thing you sit on. You might have it in your purse. Pull your wallet out of your pocket and hold it up in there. Can anybody do that?
Yes.
There we go. Okay, I have some participants. All right. The reason we're doing this is we want God to bless the work of our hands. We want Him to bless our finances. But it comes by obeying the Word of God. If you totally ignore the Word of God, you're not going to be blessed. So, Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we ask, Lord God, that you bless our finances, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we want to build our house upon the rock, Lord God, because we believe you. You're the one that reached in our hearts and saved us and granted us eternal life. So, Father, I just pray that you bless the work of our hands and bless our finances as we give unto you in the name of Jesus. And they all said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, and y'all can go forward. Thank you. So many years ago, I was born in the kingdom of God, probably just barely post Jesus Freak movement. And so I was part of the later movement of that reign. And I had read and knew about this man named John Osteen. And I don't really know if all these stories are true, but these are the stories I heard. He was a reaper. What I call a reaper is somebody that just knows how to bring people to Jesus. God has just anointed him to preach the word, and people just come to Jesus. So it's my understanding, the Jesus Freak movement, that he would preach the gospel in his church, and there would literally be policemen in the church building. Because what would happen is the hippies would come, and they would receive the Lord Jesus Christ, and they would come, and they would put all their drugs in the offering plate. And that's why the police were there. They would gather the drugs and haul them off. But the man just knew how to reap people into the kingdom of God. God anointed him for that. And so, having said that, I want you to know that Keith Needham was the disciple of John Osteen. And with no further ado, let's clap our hands for Keith Needham and have him come forward. And give him time.
Well, hallelujah. They said, how are you doing? When I walked in, I said, I've been driving and driving and driving. But I made it. Now, are these the ones you set for me?
No.
Oh, okay. The Lord made them show up miraculously. I couldn't find my glasses earlier. I had left them back there in the back. I think I'm going to go with the scripture I told you, but I don't know. You know, I'm one of these people. Pastor Osteen trained me to follow the Holy Ghost. And so I just follow the Holy Ghost. I don't get under any pressure to do anything spectacular. I just let Jesus be Jesus. He does a lot better job than I could ever dream up anyway. So I just let him do what he wants to do. And in a minute, I'm going to have you stand up and do something, but let's go ahead and stand up right now. Let's go ahead and stand up. I'll have you do this in just a minute. But the Lord put something on my heart while I was sitting there just a moment ago. He said, we need to get the people in one accord. A lot of times, you know, we take it for granted that when we come in and we all worship God together, that we get into one accord. But that's not always the case. And so we need to get into one accord. So I'm going to pray a little prayer. That doesn't mean we haven't been. So please don't go out here and say, Pastor Mike, Brother Keith said that we weren't in one accord, because I said, no, I didn't say that. So I just want us to really focus on something here. And I'm going to pray a prayer. I want you to pray with me. Lord Jesus, we come to you today. I ask that you would cause us to be in one accord. One accord means we're all in agreement. And the agreement that we come to is that the Holy Ghost is in charge. No man will take glory for what's done in this church. It will be Jesus. Father, I ask that you keep our minds and hearts alert as we learn from your word today, and you visit your presence upon us with the strongest movement possible. I ask you this, and the people in this church ask you this in Jesus' name, and we pray and agree together. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Okay, well, go reach down and get your Bible. I'm going to have you hold up your Bible just a second. I know most of you have electronic Bibles now, so you hold your phones up. That's just fine with me. Now, when that first started happening, I almost had a stroke. I said, why does everyone in here, Jesus, have something electronic in their hand? I thought everybody was texting while I was preaching. So don't text while I preach. Okay. I want you to say this like you mean it. Think about what you're saying. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
I am what it says I am.
I am what it says I am.
I have what it says I have.
I have what it says I have.
I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says I can do.
Today I will be taught the Word of God.
Today I will be taught the Word of God.
I boldly confess.
I boldly confess.
My mind is alert.
My mind is alert.
My heart is receptive.
My heart is receptive.
I will never be the same.
I will never be the same.
I am about to receive.
I am about to receive.
The incorruptible.
The incorruptible.
Indestructible.
Ever living.
Ever living.
Seed.
Of the Word of God.
Of the Word of God.
I'll never be the same.
I'll never be the same.
Never, never, never.
Never, never, never.
I'll never be the same.
I'll never be the same.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Praise God. You may be seated. Now, give me a minute here to get my plane up in the air, and I'll tell you which direction we're going to go once I start flying here. But I got to get some altitude first. So, I think I know where I'm going, but I'm not certain. You know, I was thinking on the way here, next week I will have been saved for 47 years. Can I get an amen? You know, some of you in here, that's longer than you've been on the earth. I couldn't say that when I first started preaching. I think I preached my first sermon when I was 16. So it's been a while. But also, next year I will have been filled with the Holy Ghost for 45 years. Hallelujah. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, folks, there is a difference between being saved and living in this world and being saved and filled with the Holy Ghost and living in this world as there is as being a man and a woman. And I do believe there's a difference. So if you're on the other side of that, just forget about that last thing I said. But, you know, on the way here, I was praying about that. And I said, Lord, you know, and I thought, man, how many times have I preached? And the one thing I always pray before I preach is, Lord, please cause me to help and not hurt.
Amen.
The people.
Amen.
Help me to help, but not ever hurt the people. God didn't send me here to fleece the sheep. God didn't send me here to beat the sheep. God sent me here to feed the sheep. So my goal today is that we be blessed, that we be fed, that we learn, and that maybe even we be challenged a little bit for this new year that's coming up. I want you to turn in your Bibles to the book of John chapter 16. John chapter 16. I was trying to think about, over the last few days particularly, if you ever watch the news, you know you're messed up. What is the church's greatest need right now? That's what I was thinking about over the last few days. And I've been in this long enough, and I was mentored by Pastor Osteen, and I've been preaching on my own since Pastor Osteen went to heaven in 1999. And I've seen different eras of the church. You talked about the Jesus Freak movement. I came in and got real fanatical and got mixed up with all you fanatics right at the end of the charismatic renewal, what we call the charismatic renewal. And I've watched the church as it has gone through a metamorphosis over the last 47 years that I've been saved. I got saved when I was about 6 months old. And no, that's not true. And I have watched things change in the church world. And the one thing that I see, folks, that I want to affect change in is that the church body is not fulfilled in its spiritual life. I've never seen it to the extent that I'm seeing it now. They're just not fulfilled. And I could blame this one and blame this one and blame that movement and blame that movement. But really, instead of doing that, what I'd really like to talk to you about is how to obtain true spiritual fulfillment. So I think that's the direction I'm going to go with this. I knew the scripture. I just didn't really know what I was going to say about it. And I had some things written down. I may say them, I may not. I'm just going to obey the Holy Ghost. But I want you to understand what I'm about to read here in the book of John. It tells us very clearly how to have true spiritual fulfillment. Now, I've been around long enough now that I've lived it. And I understand where that true spiritual fulfillment comes from. So I'm going to read to you. I'm reading from the Amplified Bible, the 1987 version of the Amplified Bible, because I don't care much for the 2015 version of the Amplified Bible, because Zondervan went in there and decided to take a lot of stuff out because it didn't fit in with the current movement in the world today. Well, I like the original. I wish they'd have left it alone. So I'm keeping my 1987 version. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I say, don't take it out. Leave it alone. We ought not to. Didn't intend to say this, but maybe this is where the Holy Ghost is leading me. We ought not to have Christianity based upon what's going on in the earth today.
Yes.
I think I just found my altitude. I mean, to tell you the truth, I mean, people have just gone crazy in the world. And I don't mean to be critical of it, but they don't know how to define a man. They don't know how to define a woman. In California, if you call your child by the wrong pronoun, they'll take your child away from you and put you in jail. We ought not to base our Christianity and what we're doing in the church on what's going on out there. Here's the blueprint. And it hadn't changed.
Amen.
God's not going to change it to accommodate the world.
Yeah,
I found my altitude, Jesus. Thank you. Okay, so I'm in John 16. This is verse 7. Jesus is speaking here to his disciples. If you are a disciple of Jesus, say, I am.
I am.
He says, however, I'm telling you nothing but the truth. When I tell you it is profitable, it is good, expedient, it is advantageous for you that I go away. Because if I do not go away, the comforter, the counselor, the helper, the advocate, the intercessor, the strengthener, the standby. I love all those names of the Holy Ghost. I mean, whatever you need him to be. And then if you go through all of them and there's nothing left, he's just a standby waiting to see what you need. The standby, the Holy Ghost, all these things, he will not come to you into close fellowship with you. But if I go away, I will send him to you. You see, Jesus said, I have to go back to the Father, not so that I can send the Holy Ghost into the world. And a lot of times we mess that up. No, Jesus went back to the Father so that he could send the Holy Ghost to you. Everybody shout, me.
Me.
How many of you have had the experience with the Holy Ghost coming into you? Well, praise God. Then you know what he's talking about here. He said, I'm going back to the Father so I can send the Holy Ghost to you. And when he comes where? When he comes into you. So you just put your name in there. This is how I read that. And when he comes into key. When he comes into key. When he comes into key. When the Holy Ghost comes into key, what's going to happen? Here's your key to spiritual fulfillment. When the Holy Ghost comes into you, when he comes, verse 8, he will convict and convince the world and bring demonstration to it. And I'm going to stop right there in the middle. When the Holy Ghost comes into you, he will convict and convince the world. How is the Holy Ghost coming in you going to do that? Because he's going to bring demonstration to the world. And he goes on to say about sin, righteousness, and judgment. But listen, here's the thrust of what I'm telling you today, church, is that the Holy Ghost came into you. You were baptized in the Holy Ghost. You began speaking in other tongues by way of the Holy Ghost, not just so that you could build yourself up spiritually, and that's part of it, not just so that you could get your spirit man in communication with God, and that's part of it, but it's to bring to the world a demonstration of God's power.
Amen.
And the key to spiritual fulfillment, I've learned in the 45 years that I've been filled with the Holy Ghost, is to keep my demonstrator on. And I was sitting here and I thought, you know, a lot of us, for different reasons, have either done it ourselves or have had the devil do it, and our demonstrator's been turned off. And church, let me tell you, on 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, it is time for us to make sure as we're going into this new year that our demonstrator is powered up and turned on for the world to see some stuff take place. Isn't that good?
Yes.
See, sometimes you just wait on the Lord. He'll let you know what you're supposed to talk about. You just have to wait. So the demonstrator, I remember so clear. The demonstrator, I'll give you points. Point number one, the key of spiritual fulfillment is that you have your demonstrator turned on. That's the first point. You have to have your demonstrator turned on. Everybody say this. Say point number one.
Point number one.
My demonstrator must be on.
My demonstrator must be on.
When I got filled with the Holy Ghost that night, I tell you, I came out of that church talking in tongues. They put me in the back seat of a car talking in tongues. They drove me home talking in tongues. I was afraid to stop because I was afraid I'd lose it. And you understand, I had been trained against it. Because everybody said, God bless the Baptists. Because in my Baptist church, we didn't do that. And that's where I got saved, and I'm thankful for my Baptist background. But here I was, a little 12-year-old boy now, and I'm speaking in some language I've never heard before. And I just got in the back of that car, and they drove me home. I remember when they got there, the lady picked me up and pushed me toward the door of my parents. They managed apartments. They pushed me to the door of the apartment, and I walked in, and my mom was on the sofa, and her back was toward me. And I saw her lying there, and I ran over to her, and I said, "Come on, out of my shoulder, and I'm gonna call Cindy out of my car." And she ran in the other direction. Well, when she started running, I had never been in any of this. You know, I didn't know what to do, but for some reason, her running got me excited, and I took out running through the apartment, speaking in tongues. You understand? My demonstrator was on. It was on full speed. And the key to spiritual fulfillment is that your demonstrator be on. It needs to be on. It needs to be on. Everybody say this again. Say point one.
Point one.
My demonstrator must be on.
My demonstrator must be on.
So that's the first thing I want to tell you. You can keep on. I'm going to kind of skip around a little bit here about your demonstrator here. He says that when that demonstrator is on, he will convince the world. A lot of times we get the idea that the only way we're going to get people saved, you know, is to go out there with the billy club and level them in the head and drag them by the nape of the neck back into the church and throw them down at the altar and say, "Now get right, turn or burn." And we're standing there ready to beat them if they don't turn. That's not God's plan. God's plan is that your demonstrator be so fired up that people in the world look at you and say, "I would give anything to have what you have. Just tell me how to get it." Amen. 45 years, I can't tell you how many times, hundreds, thousands of times that people have come to the Lord because my demonstrator is on. I never turn it off. I just go out and act naturally. I don't have to go out and pretend. I just do what I am. I'm a fanatic. So I just go out and I do fanatic. Right in front of the world. I'm real good at it. You know, Pastor, you were talking about Pastor Osteen. Pastor Osteen used to say to me, like, say, "You know, the least we could do is not be hypocrites." You know what a hypocrite is? A hypocrite is someone pretending to be something that they're not. And a lot of us come to church, and I'm not trying to be critical, but I've watched it, not you, because I don't go to church with you, but I've watched they're in the church, and they're praising and speaking in tongues and dancing and carrying on, and then they go out into the world, and they turn it off. That's hypocrisy. I mean, we get to the other end. We think people pretend to be Christians. We don't have that problem in America right now. We don't have people pretending to be Christians right now in America. Not too often. We're on the other side of that now. And again, if you've watched the news, you know what I'm talking about. The two things you don't want to be in America. One is a Christian and the other is a Jew. Do you know that? Mm-hmm. I won't get too much into that. But your demonstrator needs to be on. Number one. And here's number two. It says he will convict and convince the world and bring a demonstration to it. Number two, your demonstrator needs to be on to change the world. The world. Everybody shout the world.
World.
Everybody say this. Say point number two.
Point number two.
My demonstrator must be on.
My demonstrator must
be on. To change the world.
To change the world.
You understand, God's plan isn't just that we come to the church house and that we have our demonstrator on in here so that we can truly engage in praise and worship and all the different things like that. That's really not God's full plan. God's full plan is that our demonstrator be on to bring a convincing argument to the world. to the world out there. People, that word, the world there is not people who are saved. Not people who are in the church, but people who are in the streets. It's the people out there in the world that need to have our demonstration as Jesus said, like a light before them. Don't put your candle out in front of them. Let your demonstrator be on in front of them. You can change the world through your demonstration. Hey, and folks, you don't have to go out and, just work yourself to death in evangelism. Just be normal. Jesus, you know, we get this mixed up a lot of times too. Jesus said, how many of you believe Jesus? If you really believe him, put your hand up. Jesus said, once the Holy Ghost comes upon you, he didn't say you'll go out and witness. That's not what he said. He said, and when the Spirit has come upon you, you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and into the uttermost parts of the earth. Thus, baptism in the Holy Ghost, when we get filled as Christians with the Holy Ghost and begin to speak in other tongues, we are immediately transformed into witnesses. So that wherever we go, that witness is upon us. Are you listening to what I'm saying this morning? We're kind of quiet. That's okay. I'm kind of in a teaching mode anyway. So that's probably the Holy Ghost. Amen. You say, well, I don't know how. Well, number one, make sure your demonstrator's on. Number two, make sure your demonstrator's on for the world and not just the church body. You know, we all want, how many of you want supernatural signs in your life? Raise your hand. How many of you, just be honest, you say, you know, I don't want any supernatural signs. Jesus, if you're coming in here to give signs, don't give one to me. Pass me by, Lord. Isn't that an old hymn? Pass me by? Or pass me not? Something like that. Pass me by, Lord. Well, we all want that supernatural. You know how you get that? I'm going to quote a scripture to you. Mark 16. Jesus said to his disciples right before he ascended back to the Father, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Last thing he told them. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. He who believes not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. I used to quote that wrong. And Pastor Osteen actually corrected me one day. Because he had quoted it wrong to me. And that's where I got it. I used to say signs are supposed to follow every... I didn't say supposed to. I said signs will follow every believer. One day Pastor Osteen said, that's not right. The Bible says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and these signs shall follow you. Signs follow the believers who go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Yeah. You can't just take half of it, you got to take all of it. I said, well, that's good. How'd you come up with that, Brother Osteen? He said, the Holy Ghost. I said, well, I'm going to preach it like I thought of it. And I do. So, you want signs in your life, but you have to go out into the world. Your demonstrator has to be on while you're out there in the world. So, number one, you have to have your demonstrator on. Number two, you have to go into the world with that demonstrator on. And folks, don't confuse what I'm saying. When I say you have to go into the world, I'm not saying you go out there and live like the world. You don't go out and participate in what the world does. You're different than the world. I mean, it's like mixing oil and water. You can't do that. But you don't alienate yourself from them either and never have any contact with anybody except your Christian friends on Facebook. Uh-oh. You have to get out among them so that they can see your light. You know, the Bible says over there in Corinthians about speaking in tongues. Tongues are for a sign. Not to those who believe, but to those who don't believe. Where are the non-believers? They're not in here. So the tongues have to be heard by them out there. You get that? Tongues are for a sign to the unbeliever. And tongues is just one thing. It could be a lot of different things there. Here's number three. I'm going to take this next word here. It says, he will convict and convince the world. I said, number one, make sure your demonstrator's on. Number two, make sure that you go into the world with that demonstrator on. And then number three, he will bring to it demonstration. Number three, you are to, I'm giving you a commission and the Holy Ghost just fell on me. You are supposed to bring a bold demonstration to the world about the Holy Ghost. A bold demonstration. I think this is more relevant today as we're going into 2024 than it's ever been in my life. And I've been preaching a lot of years now. I'm telling you, the world is not ashamed of its filth. And the world, and I'm not being critical either, is totally confused right now. They have lost their minds. And that's about as nice as I can be. Can you define the woman? Well, you know, you have to put it in context.
Yeah.
That's just one thing. We have to have a bold demonstration of the Holy Ghost. That's what will change the world. I feel like telling you a story. You know, I got saved when I was 10, and I got filled with the Holy Ghost when I was 12, all about the same time. And, my family didn't serve the Lord. I was the only one in there that served the Lord. Now, my mom, they all had a Christian background. My mom was raised in the Baptist church, and she had attended church until I was born, and I don't know what happened. My father was raised Pentecostal. And so he knew the Bible, and he just didn't practice it and didn't want to hear anything about it. So I come along and I got saved and I messed up everything in my family. I mean to tell you, I wanted to pray before meals. They didn't want to do that. I wanted to go to church. Nobody was going to church. They had to get out of bed and take me to church on Sunday because I was only 10. Couldn't get there by myself. I mean, I just brought all kinds of confusion and consternation into that family. And now, ultimately, I'll say this. My mom and my dad did come to Jesus before they went to heaven. And, you know, something I prayed about my whole life. And I said, Lord, you promised me. And I just beat the doors of heaven with that until finally they did get saved before they died. But listen, when I was growing up, and particularly after I started going to John Osteen's church, they weren't happy people. First of all, from my hometown of Bay City, Texas, my church was about an hour and a half. And I started going to college in San Marcos, and church was 172 miles one way. And one day my father said, that's it, we're not paying for this anymore. We're not going to pay for your college. We're not doing anything if you continue to keep going to that church. And I said, well, do what you have to do. I'm staying where God's told me to go. I said, the Lord will make a way. And, you know, and one day, I think it was maybe over Christmas break or maybe it was over the summer. I don't remember what. And I had an older brother. He's about 5 years older than I am. And he and I never saw eye to eye on anything, particularly after I started talking in tongues. I mean, were your relatives just delighted when you came home talking in tongues? Oh, praise the Lord. Well, I had been at church all day. We had three services on Sunday, and I was there for a long time. And I had come home that night, and my parents had put me back in the back bedroom in the back side of this apartment because all I did all day was pray and watch Pastor Osteen on TV and speak in tongues, and they put me back there. They kind of shut me out until I went back to school. And my brother was in the middle bedroom. He was still at home. I guess he was probably about 23, 24 years old, and he had returned home, and my parents, only a two-bedroom apartment, my parents had moved out into the living room, and they were sleeping on the sofa bed, and that way I could be back there and pray and not bother people, you see, so I came home one night from church, and my mom and dad, they had fallen asleep on the bed there, and the TV was on, and I walked into the kitchen. My mom would always leave food out for me, because we were in church from 8 in the morning until 10:30 at night. And I came in, I was getting me something to eat. I'm talking about the Holy Ghost wants to bring a bold demonstration into you people. And I was standing there, I don't remember what it was, I was getting something off the stove, and something came on that television. And I'm not sure what it was, but I do know it was not godly. It had really, really bad language on it. It was sexual. People were doing all kinds of things that I can't mention in the church. And I was standing there at the stove, and suddenly the Holy Ghost on the inside of me arose inside of me with indignation. Now, my brother's room was right there, and his door was open, and he was watching TV in his room. I didn't intend to do this. I'm just me. You understand? And when that came on that TV, it just grieved my spirit. And just out of nowhere, seemingly, I went, and my brother said, hey, and he jumped up and slammed his bedroom door, and my mom said, Doug, turn off the TV, and he ran over and he turned the TV off. I got my food and went to my bedroom. Do you know that incident was the turning point in my family? The turning point. My brother was he was mean. I never, ever had any more problems with my brother. Never. He left me alone, honey. Now, my parents, as I said, they weren't church-going people. They talked like the world. Now, they didn't do worldly things so much, but they talked like the world. Their ideas were like the world. And man alive, I tell you, growing up, even after I got filled with the Holy Ghost, those 5 years before I started going to John Osteen's church, I would be at home and I would be so grieved because of the worldliness that was going on that I was living in. All of a sudden, it changed after that night. People, all of a sudden in my house, stopped cursing. I never heard the Lord's name used in vain anymore. What did I do? I said, Korama Shandalabokuta. And that changed it. Listen, folks, one bold demonstration of the Holy Ghost is worth more than 25 years of your struggling and praying and crying a bathtub full of tears and wearing your knees out at the altar. Be bold in the Holy Ghost. Well, I told that story. I might as well tell another one. We'll make sure I'm get you out on time. But I'm having a pretty good time now. Well, that happened probably around 1987, something like that. I remember something like that. I'm going to go back a couple of years even before that. You know, about 8 weeks ago, I went down to my high school's 38th reunion. Now I have a friend from high school who we were in contact with during the course of planning this reunion. And he said, are you going to be? I said, yes, I'm going to be there, Zeke. I'm going to be there. And so he ended up showing up at the reunion. His mother that morning had suffered a heart failure. And he had been at the hospital with her all day. And I didn't think he was going to make it. And then he showed up. And by the way, she did go on to be with the Lord here about 2 weeks ago. And this happened just recently. And so when he showed up at the reunion that day, we were at the park, and I think it was October 21st on a Saturday, and he showed up and he said, there was a reason I told you you have to be here at this reunion, Keith. And I said, Zeke, what is it? He said, he's a pastor now. He said, I want you to know that I am a born-again, spirit-filled Christian because of you. I had no idea what he was talking about. I said, what do you mean because of me? He said, you don't remember what you did to me? I said, no, it had to be 40 years ago what he said. He said, you got me in your car to hear some music. And he said, I was just a good Catholic. Everybody say, God bless the Catholics. He said, I was just a good Catholic minding my own business. And you got me in that car and you turned that music on. And we were driving down the road. You weren't even looking at the road. Both of your hands were up in the air. You were talking in some language I didn't know. All I heard was in between this and that. I heard a few praise the Lords and hallelujahs. And I remember thinking to myself, what on earth is wrong with him? He said, and then a couple of weeks later, you dragged me to your church. I don't remember any of it. He said, and then everybody in there was just as fanatical as you were. And he said, I left out of there thinking, I'd give anything in the world to have what they have. Give anything in the world. Well, I lost contact with Zeke. He actually quit school early so that he could support his family. But now I know what happened. He quit school early. He got born again. He got filled with the Holy Ghost. He got called to the ministry. And now he's a pastor up in Texarkana. But one demonstration of the Holy Ghost, and I don't even remember it. A bold demonstration of speaking in tongues. A bold demonstration of praise. How about this? A bold demonstration of love. That same day, I'll throw this in for extra. That same day as we were there in the park, this girl walked up to me. I don't know who she was. And she said, "Oh my gosh, Keith, I am so glad to see you." I said, "Well, you know, okay, great." I said, "Who are you?" She said, "You don't remember me?" I said, "I'm sorry, but I don't." She said, "38 years ago, she said, you and Reggie." Well, Reggie was a friend of mine. I got out after I graduated from high school because I couldn't find any spirit-filled Christian people there and where I was living. So I took him and got him saved and filled with the Holy Ghost so I'd have a spirit-filled friend. And I'm just kind of joking about that. And she said to me, just about every other night in 1985, you and Reggie came to my house. I said, "We did? Reggie's in heaven now." I said, "We did?" She said, "Yes." I said, "What did we do?" She said, "You sat down and you told me that God loved me, that God was not so concerned with the sin I committed. He just wanted my heart, that I couldn't live the life I needed to live until I got born again, that I was trying to be a swimmer without going into the water, and you told me I had to get born again so that I could live the Christian life, and you told me God would not hold my past against me." And she said, "You talked month after month after month," and she said, "It changed my life forever." Well, just a bold demonstration. I don't even remember. I wish I could remember her name. I don't remember doing that. And folks, please don't misinterpret what I'm saying. I'm not trying to brag on Brother Keith. You understand that? I just always make sure that my demonstrator is on. Don't turn off your demonstrator. Let the Holy Ghost live big in you in 2024. The Holy Ghost wants to convert some of your family members. But you've gotten into the habit, and I do the same thing, when you go around your family members, see, you tone it down. You ought not to tone it down, you ought to tone it up. They don't tone it down around us. They really don't. I mean, they're just as foul as they ever were. One demonstration of the Holy Ghost. Well, I'll tell you one more thing, and then I'll give you another point, because I want four, not just three, and then I'll close. I remember I'm talking about going into the world. I was about to tell you, a few years ago, they called me and asked me to come on TBN, and they put me on there. They wanted to find out what my ministry was and how I managed and developed it, and I sat there and I felt like a lamb to the slaughter. I said, "I don't do any of that." They said, "What do you do?" I said, "I just rely on the Holy Ghost." And they had that big camera up in my face. And I was sitting there looking at that Indian man, and he was interviewing me. He was a pastor from Houston. And here I am on television. And he said, "Well, tell me about your relationship with John Osteen." I said, "I'd rather talk to you about my relationship with Jesus." Right in the big middle of that, the Holy Ghost came on me. I was looking at that man, and just as clear as I see you sitting here, I saw a woman pass right in front of his face. And I knew what it was. Somebody who was watching by TV needed to be healed. I saw the woman, her throat had closed up on her. She couldn't talk. And he was talking to me, and I just stopped, and I said, "Can I obey the Holy Ghost?" He said, "Yes, sir." I turned and I looked into the camera. I said, "There is a woman watching me." I said, "You have something wrong with your throat. I don't know what it is, but it's closed off. And the Lord wants to open your throat up right now." That man grabbed my hand, started talking in tongues, honey. We got the Holy Ghost loose. I commanded her throat to open up through those airwaves. Next thing I knew, she was calling the TV station to say that she had been healed. And they gave me her phone number. And I called her when I got out, and I said, "How are you?" She said, "I'm fine." She said, "My throat's been closed up. I don't know what's wrong with it." What if I would have said, "Well, you know what? I'm on TV. I better be gentle." That wasn't even really in the world, but in some ways it is. I was about to tell you, when I walked into my dormitory, and they had some filthy stuff on that TV. It just drove me up the wall. And I had a friend in there. God bless the Baptist. He was a Baptist. He was saved. But I talked to him about the Holy Ghost, and he had gotten filled with the Holy Ghost, and he was back in his room. And I walked through that lobby, and they were cursing and doing all kinds of stuff. I got mad. You ever get mad about stuff like that?
Yeah.
It's a righteous indignation. It's not normal. And I went back there. I said, Roy? He said, what? I told him what was going on at the lobby. He said, what are we going to do? And, you know, I knew a little bit of the Bible. I was only about 19 at the time. I said, we're going to go outside, and we're going to put the praises of God on our lips, and we're going to boldly march around this dormitory 7 times, lifting up the praises of God. And I meant it. So here we come, 2 Reformed Baptists. And, you know, they were cussing and carrying on. They were hanging out the windows, drinking. I mean, typical dorm stuff. And we started. We were kind of quiet at first, and we were praising. I remember saying, blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. I mean, we were singing, and we were having a good time. But that 7th time, the Holy Ghost fell. And when the Holy Ghost fell, it got wild. And we were speaking in tongues. We're casting out demons. Next thing I know, that's a terrible sound. They came over and they got a hold of me, and when they dragged us up to the front of the dorm, they were shining the lights in our eyes. I thought we were drunk. Fortunately, I had a spirit-filled headmaster. They were called, the person in charge of the dorm, anyway. The head resident is what they're called. I had a spirit-filled head resident. He came out. He said, "Oh, officer, they're just excited about Jesus. You just gotta overlook them and forgive them." And you know, I believe in complying with the authorities, and I also believe in staying out of jail. I'm too pretty to go to jail. And so I looked at the man. I said, "That's right. I'm just excited about Jesus. Overlook my sin." And he looked at me and he said, because Roy was kind of quiet back then, he looked at me and he said, "Sir, you cannot come out here. I understand that you believe that everybody wants to hear this." And he said, "But you cannot come out here and force your religiosity upon other people." Well, that just set me off. And if I remember the way it went correctly, I looked back at him and I said, "Wait a minute. Number one, you're wrong. I don't believe any of them want to hear what we just did. That's why we did it." I said, "Number two, I've been on this campus long enough. I've seen everything from panty raids," if you don't know what that is, don't ask, "from panty raids to pornographic protests on this campus because they want more pornography. And I have watched as the officers of the law have stood on the parameters of the campus because too many people are marching, and you've thrown up your hands and you said, 'What can we do?' And you just let them go on with their filth and idolatry. And yet 2 people," I said, "look, two people begin to praise God, and you're down here with your sirens blowing, and you're down here with your lights flashing, threatening to take us to jail." I said, "Sir, don't you see something wrong with this scenario?" I was pretty bold as a 19-year-old. You know, the reason I told you that, and that'll be my last story, is that I can't tell you how many people were changed as a result of that. For 2 years, I lived in that dorm after that, and I had dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of people come to me seeking prayer, come to me wanting to be born again. And you know Brother James, who used to be here as your worship leader, he came to me and he said, "I know you're one of those fanatics, and I want to be filled with the Holy Ghost." He was a good Baptist. He got filled with the Holy Ghost. Just that one demonstration of the Holy Ghost. Now, you don't have to be some crazy off the wall, you know, and I sometimes am a little more radical than even others. I understand that. You don't have to be that way. But your demonstrator needs to be on in front of the world. I told you, number one, your demonstrator needs to be on. I told you, number two, your demonstrator needs to be on for the world. And I told you, number three, your demonstrator is supposed to bring a bold, convincing argument to the world. And I close with this. Number four, the devil has a twofold plan in this day. One is that you and I will just not ever go out into the world. I've never seen it so easy as it is now for Christians to isolate themselves. We come to, and I'm not being critical, we come to church, and because the world's gotten so crazy, we have our circle of Christian friends, and we never venture out to where worldly people are, and we never let them see our demonstration. Never. So number one is just to keep us away from people. Number two would be, I got it. Number two would be that when we do see them, if we do go out there, our demonstrator's turned off because we don't want to endure any criticism. I mean, my pastor was put on trial for the Holy Ghost. Wow. Public trial. And sometimes I feel guilty because I feel like I don't even want to be condemned, criticized for the Holy Ghost. Yet he was put on trial. And as a result, folks, of what the devil's trying to do to us, and I'm not being critical of any person, but you know, people turn to Oprah for spiritual advice. Am I telling the truth?
Yes.
Listen, church, let's make sure that our Christianity and our evangelism goes beyond a religious post on Facebook. It's real easy for us to just, now at this point, with the world gone so crazy, for us just to turn a blind eye to the world and say, you know what, I don't want anything to do. But there are a lot of people out there who are thirsty, who are hungry, who are just waiting for you to show up with a demonstration of the Holy Ghost, a demonstration of other tongues, a demonstration of love and compassion. A demonstration of meeting the needs of someone who needs help. A demonstration of forgiveness. A demonstration of patience. A demonstration of praise. In the midst of a world where everybody is glorifying Satan, you lift your hands and glorify God.
Amen.
I mean, that's supernatural. All those things are supernatural. When I was here the last time, I told you to hold on to some things. That title was Hold Fast. I said today my title is, and I guess it was, a key to maintaining or to acquiring spiritual fulfillment. This is how we do it. But rest assured, folks, you will never be entirely spiritually fulfilled until that demonstrating switch is flipped on inside of you and you're affecting change out there in the world in which you live. Was that all right this morning?
Amen.
All right, give Jesus a big hand. Let's all stand up and let's see where the Holy Ghost wants to take us. Glory to you, my Father. Amen. Glory to you, my Father. Glory to you, my Father. Father, we thank you that your Spirit is among us this morning. We thank you that you're present ever when we show up with the Holy Ghost to perform signs and wonders and miracles. We thank you that your body is equipped with the Holy Ghost to go forth and effect change in this generation in which we live. You know, this is what I feel like we ought to do. I feel like we ought to pray together, and I'm going to lead you in this prayer. And folks, I want you to understand that this prayer I'm going to lead you in is just as much for me as it is for you. I mean, I'm not anything special. I have one friend, he keeps telling me, he says, no, but you have a special relationship with God. I'm like, Jerry, I don't have any, stop saying that, I told him. I don't have any special relationship with God. I said, your relationship with God is just as tremendous and as special as you think mine is.
Amen.
So I'm nothing special. And by that I mean we're all the tools by which Jesus can use, change the world. So this is just as much for me as it is for you. Let's pray this out loud. I tell you, do us good to lift our hands up. Let's lift our hands up and pray. Say, oh God.
Oh God.
I come to you this morning.
I come to you this morning.
The last day of this year.
The last day of this year.
And I set myself apart.
And I set myself apart.
To be a demonstrator.
To be a demonstrator.
Of the Holy Ghost.
Of the Holy Ghost.
I pray, oh God.
I pray, oh God.
That you would use me.
That you would use me.
To affect change in this world.
That you would affect change in this world.
That you would cause me to be bold.
That you would cause me to be bold.
Be a bold demonstrator.
Be a bold demonstrator.
Of your Holy Ghost.
Of your Holy Ghost.
Of speaking in tongues.
Of speaking in tongues.
Of meeting people's needs.
Of meeting people's needs.
Of showing unconditional love.
Of showing unconditional love.
Of demonstrating forgiveness.
Of demonstrating forgiveness.
Of encouraging people.
Of encouraging people.
In helping the lonely.
Of helping the lonely.
And the suffering.
And the suffering.
And those who are confused.
And those who are confused.
About morality.
About morality.
And choices.
And choices.
I don't come to condemn them, Lord.
I don't come to condemn them, Lord.
I come to bring a demonstration.
I come to bring a demonstration
of the Holy Ghost.
Of the Holy Ghost.
So that they can see the way.
So they can see the way.
The truth.
The truth.
And the life.
And the life.
Are only in Jesus Christ.
It's only in Jesus Christ.
Cause me to be bold.
Cause me to be bold.
And to keep my demonstrator switch on.
And to keep my demonstrator switch on.
You know, this is what the Lord is putting in my spirit right now. If you're here and you feel like that demonstration switch on the inside of you has been either, I don't know how to explain it. Lord, give me the words. If you feel that switch either has been turned off by yourself or situations in the world have caused that switch to be turned off, I want you to make your way down to this altar. I'm going to quickly come by and lay hands on you. I'm not going to take a lot of time unless the Lord tells me to. You know, the oil symbolizes the Holy Ghost, and I just suddenly got that in my spirit. I don't always anoint with oil. This is what we're going to do. When I come by and I lay hands on you, you're going to, in your spirit, I want you to imagine. No, the Lord says don't do that. I want you to imagine yourself flipping that switch on. I was about to say, I want you to imagine the Holy Ghost doing it. The Holy Ghost said, I'm not doing that. You got to turn it on yourself. So I want you to imagine your spirit being that blank, thank you, sir, being that blank slate here where your ignition switch is. We're just going to come by and we're going to anoint you. I'm going to come by, I'm going to touch you, I'm going to move quickly. And when I touch you, I want you to begin to pray in other tongues. And that's the symbol that switch is being turned on. Hallelujah. Are you in agreement with me? Say, I'm in agreement, Brother Keith. Thank you, brother. Father, as I lay my hands upon these people, I'm not going to pray over each individual one. I'm simply going to touch them. As I do, I pray, Lord, that you would cause that switch, cause them to turn that on and to leave it on for the duration of 2024. In the name of Jesus Christ. Okay, when I touch you, you can go ahead. Some of you already started, that's fine. Begin to pray in other tongues. Korapata shugle dina na kita tata. Orapakasapa. Orikanamata. Arikanamata. Arikanamatata bose. Leva do mokorato bose. Mariana maha. Kose. Oh! Hey, ataba soto. Eva do moroko drihini katanda. Reklapaka. Reklapaka. Reklapaka ta ba si to ni kanda le bloko traha da masa ta da kasa kuda ko kori na masa ta ta ba kata da ba e bloko ringa da ma no ni ka sa traha ta da ba si te ye ko so ko pa traha pa waiti ni 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 kanda da ba so te waiti ni ni ne ma kula la la ba shora na na kata ta da ba so te waiti ni ni na ma ko raha ba sa traha da ba sa ta Hori ga sahabu totoya. Edo bo shobola bakama tabasa taingo. Roboto sapataki sadamado mushiri gedada. Demo rondo boko trahati kesa trahatata da boko trahama. Belo botu kutumba shutre kataba. Ho repete kesa haya hamo kota. Halaya, 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 halaya taba. Zeba togomo, zeba togomo, zeba togomo. Seta, nina kataba sote. Gareta basuki kataba. Bojo botro hugo kataba pika. Boza taba katata basa. Zuri rasta. O jabanda da basa trahata bakandito boso treta da baala mo pe. E boko trahama di goshu mo takata. Wefi di gishiba. Ora! Ora! For some reason the anointing is increasing. Kora basa. Ope kana ate. Ope kana ate. Ope kana ate. So bose. Ritanda la batra. Ote kaka kasanda da boso e. Wei polo boko rihitana. Wei polo boko rihanda na basote. Wei polo boko rikana mata ta basotre. Kanada na basotre tata. Wei la bahaha trehete boshuko tata ba. Ah, mana basandra hamo. Wei chini ni kasanda na basoto posoto. Eva trahama na kasata. Eva rahala bakanda mana basupo kutrahada. Wei vadama. Wei patama. Wei patama. Wei patama kasa. Eva lo boko trahada basa. Eva trohoti katama ha. Wei chini ni kando boshotre. Wei tada basupi kanda basute. Wei patama kanda na basupo kutraha batiki de basa. Ebene kopo toto kota. Wei tulo boso. Is there anyone here I didn't lay hands on? Koba shadra hara bakandro hulu bukote. We foto bukosita. Be fidikisha. We plana nana oka ati boso papaka ando bosho te de bakanda. Boranda na mahoya. Hala bukundre kina makata. Oh, that's great. I'm coming in. Ebo to go zaba ate mo shope da ba ha hi ko shu ko to ko we da ba la 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 ba kha na mo fo te de ke ni ba shope. You know folks, this is what the Lord put in my spirit here. A lot of times when we go to New Year's services or end of year services, they have you make these great proclamations, and they're wonderful, that this is going to be the year of difference. This is going to be the year of change. This is going to be the year that your family comes in. This is going to be the year that your financial dreams are met. All those things are wonderful. And I've been to many dozens of those types of things, and I've made those professions, and then nothing happened, and we did the same thing the next year. That hurts your faith. And so the reason I didn't do that, because this is what the Lord is telling me to tell you now, is that really, it's not about God showing up and showing out. It's about you with the Holy Ghost on the inside of you showing up and showing out. God trusts you so much. And when that anointing started increasing on me there, this is what happened. It was as though love engulfed me. And God is love.
Yes.
A love for you. Like I know all of you by name and I don't. And that love just wants me to tell you that God loves you so much that he put you in charge. I mean, one day you're going to judge nations, folks. One day you're going to judge fallen sinners, the Bible says in Revelation. So God trusts you enough to put you in charge. You affect that change in your family. You cause those people to come in. You have all that power within you. Everybody say, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it in Jesus' name. Well, if that was all right this morning, give Jesus a great big hand. Hallelujah. I thank you so much for having me here. I always love when Pastor Mike calls me. He almost seems apologetic. He's like, do you mind driving all that? No, Pastor Mike, just tell me when and I'll be there. And I always said, don't take up an offering for me. Just let me preach and help people. But I know you're going to take up an offering anyway. So I just want you to know how much I love you, how much God loves you. I will be here to help anytime Pastor Mike needs my help. I love Pastor Mike and Pastor Cheryl. They're great friends to me. He sent me an autographed copy of his new book. Hallelujah. So I'm in the process of reading The Path of the Righteous. And I just want you to know that my prayers are with you. And I believe that 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 is a countdown. And number 4 is when it's all going to happen and more. Because of you. And what you're carrying around on the inside of you that's about to take off. Hallelujah. Give Jesus another hand clap.
Thank the Lord. Good stuff. So I got a question. Or right, let's brother do it this way. Are you righteous?
Yes.
Are you righteous?
Yes.
The Bible says the righteous are bold as a lion. Proverbs 28:1. It says before that the wicked man flees though no one pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. So what happens, this teaching that we received from Keith, it is unlocking a door, but he's also talking about the decision on your part. And I talk to young men of God about those things all the time. Please, thank you for passing out envelopes. I talk to young men about these kind of things all the time. It's decision. I tell them, somebody's got to stand up for God. Somebody in your group of friends or in your family, somebody's got to be the one that stands up and speaks the things of God. And that's what he's talking about. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. In given situations, in marketplaces, in family gatherings, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and then you have a choice to make. Do I quench the Holy Spirit, or do I go ahead and speak it out? Because they need you to speak it out, and that's what he's talking about, because it changes people. It gives them hope, it gives them life, and if you don't speak it out, they don't get that hope and that life. You've quenched the Holy Ghost, so you want to learn. Say, the righteous are bold as a lion.
Bold as a lion.
Now we're going to do it different. I am bold as a lion.
I am bold as a lion.
I will not quench the Holy Ghost.
I will not quench the Holy Ghost.
I will speak the things of God when he moves upon my heart.
I will speak the things of God when he moves upon my heart.
And it will change things.
And it will change things.
And the wicked will flee.
And the wicked will flee.
But those that want to know the kingdom of God, they will come.
But those that want to know the kingdom of God, they will come.
And they will be set free.
They will be set free.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to go to a wonderful scripture here. Y'all can sit down if you're standing up. We're going to take up an offering. And no, Keith, we weren't going to this time. But you put me on the spot. So now, I'm just kidding. Hallelujah. But I did want to share a scripture. This is Galatians 6:6, if I'm not mistaken. Let me get there. So the different gifts that people bring to the kingdom of God, you need to learn to appreciate them, because those gifts are given to encourage and strengthen the church and assist us in doing the things of God. So in 6:6, Galatians 6:6, it says, is anyone who receives instruction in the word? Have you received instruction in the word? Okay, it goes on to say, must share all good things with their instructor. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to share good things with our instructor. So guys, y'all can, have y'all already?
Yeah.
Okay, you've already taken up an offering. All right. They're way ahead of me. I'm sorry. I forget a lot. Here's another one over here. Anybody else? There's two over here. See, you forget a lot too, sister. I threw her under the bus. That's not right. Love you, sister. Thank you for your service. Lord God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for this time together, Father. And we do declare that the righteous are bold as a lion. We do declare, Lord God, that we will not quench the Holy Spirit. Father, we will be that person that will stand up and speak the things of God, even though it may bring embarrassment or whatever. We're just going to go ahead and do it because we know that it helps people, Father. In the name of Jesus, we love you and praise you. I praise you, Father, for this upcoming year. Fill us all, Lord God, to overflowing. In the name of Jesus. And they all said,
amen.
Have a good week. Happy New Year.
Amen.